Act 3. We're happy to be joined by Tony Banbury, who, as you know, is the Assistant Secretary General in the Department of Field Service. And as I mentioned earlier, he's here to talk a bit more detail about the new allegations of sexual abuse. Tony, welcome. You have the floor.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Our peace operations, but also give you some information about the allegations that were referred to in the press statement by the High Commissioner for Human Rights today. As I think you're aware, in June of 2015, the Secretary General implemented a strengthened program of action to combat sexual exploitation and abuse in peace operations. There are three main focus of the efforts. First, prevention, most importantly, in a way, well, they're all important, but prevention. Two, response, the accountability side. And then three, victim assistance. And under the Secretary General's very strong direction, the organization has been working quite hard, well, indeed before June, but since then as well, to implement a number of measures that we hope will advance our efforts in all three of those areas. We have a significantly expanded vetting program where now every single member of a police or military contingent deployed to a peace operation is individually vetted, which never happened before, to make sure that that person has not been involved in prior misconduct in a UN operation. So anyone who's been involved in misconduct in a UN operation can now not get back in. We are requiring member states to certify that all the contingent members that they deploy have not been involved in human rights abuses or any serious crimes. We are significantly improving the links at the mission level to the communities, and this will help both with increased reporting, improved reporting of cases, but also better victim assistance, where we are very, very committed, and by working closely with communities, we think we can advance that objective. We've established in our priority missions individual response teams that can deploy within 24 hours or investigate within 24 hours. In a case of a sexual crime, that rapid response is very important to collect and preserve evidence. In the past, when we have our normal OIOS investigations, they are not like police on the scene who get called and show up in a police car with sirens. It's more of an administrative investigation. So now we're putting in place this more police-like capability with rape kits, DNA collection capabilities, special trained investigators to help collect and preserve evidence for use in a subsequent criminal proceeding, we hope, which will advance that objective of accountability. We've asked our troop contributing countries to include national investigative officers in their contingents so that they can initiate their investigation right away. We do not have to wait for someone to be sent from a capital. We have asked troop contributing countries to conclude their investigations within a maximum of 6 months. Before it was a little open-ended and we didn't always know the status of the investigation, so we've asked that they be concluded within 6 months. And we are now proactively following up with our troop contributing countries during the course of the investigation to check on the status and encourage that it is being carried out in a timely manner and concluded, and we're informed of the result. Before, we generally waited for troop contributors to inform us what's happening. Now we are engaged in much more proactive, I would say, partnership with them. We also now proactively suspend payments upon a credible allegation, payments to troop contributors. So there's no reimbursement for personnel who are credibly accused of involvement in a case of sexual exploitation and abuse. We've come under some criticism of this for punishing people even though they're innocent until proven guilty, but this reflects how strongly the Secretary General feels on the matter. And we have established a trust fund to provide for better victim assistance. These cumulative measures combined with efforts that were being made before June are having an impact. clearly one case is one case too many. The Secretary General's absolute commitment to zero tolerance is very well known, and our goal is zero. Nonetheless, we do see some improvement, some impact as a result of all these initiatives. And I can just give you a quick rundown of some numbers. In 2010, we had 85 confirmed allegations of sexual exploitation and abuse. In 2012, that was down to 60. And in 2014, it was down to 51. Unfortunately, in 2015, we're still confirming the numbers, but it's likely to be 69. So we've gone up since last year for the first time in a while. However, of those 69 cases, 22 are from MINUSCA in Central African Republic, and without MINUSCA, we'd be at 48 cases. So there'd be that downward trend continues everywhere else in the peacekeeping world, except MINUSCA. That's not to say every mission has necessarily gone down, but cumulatively, we've continued that downward slope. And in 2014, that number I cited, 51, there were no MINUSCA cases. So if we just compare apples to apples and exclude MINUSCA from 2014 and 2015, we continue that downward trajectory. However, we have to deal with MINUSCA. Now, the Secretary General is going to issue his report on special measures to combat sexual exploitation and abuse next month. That report will have still some additional measures that we will be implementing to further, to really do everything we possibly can to combat this scourge. And in his report, he will also, for the first time in such a report, as he has committed to quite some time ago, he will be identifying the countries involved in these allegations, the contingents, what countries they come from. We will be naming names. That information in the report will also be complemented and regularly updated in the website that we have, that will have much more granular information than you have ever seen before about the individual allegations, the status of the allegations, the status of the investigation, the country of origin, what disciplinary action, if any, has been, or criminal accountability has been meted out by the member state, the government. So you'll have much more information regularly updated on the website, which reflects the Secretary General's very strong commitment to transparency on these matters. And we believe that transparency is an important part of combating this incredibly difficult scourge. As part of this commitment to transparency, the Secretary General has decided that we should already start identifying the countries whose contingents are involved in some of these allegations. All will be identified starting with that report in February, but to complement the information put out by the High Commissioner for Human Rights today, where he referred to some new allegations that had been uncovered by a joint UN team that included human rights personnel, mission personnel, and other UN agency personnel. He gave information on the cases involving non-UN forces and referred to cases involving UN forces. And I want to give you the same information that he gave for the non-UN forces. I want to give you now for the allegations concerning UN forces. So I will just go through it here in alphabetical order. The first allegation involves two military personnel from Bangladesh. It involves allegations of sexual relations with a minor, possibly in exchange for money. This is alleged to have happened in November of 2015. The troop contributing country has appointed a national investigation officer who is on the ground and investigating this case. The second allegation involves the Democratic Republic of Congo, one person from their military contingent. It involves sex with a minor on several occasions between May and August of 2015. The United Nations sent the request to the DRC government asking for it to appoint a national investigative officer. We did not receive any reply within the normal 10-day time frame, so we have ourselves, OIOS, launched the investigation process in that case. The third allegation concerns Morocco, one member of its military contingent. It involves an allegation of sexual assault against a minor that took place allegedly in January of 2014. This is actually before MINUSCA existed, but Morocco had a guard unit on the ground supporting MINUSCA. The troop contributing country has appointed a national investigation officer. It's also asked for cooperation by OIOS in the investigation. The NIO, the national investigation officer, is on the ground, and that investigation is ongoing. The fourth allegation involves Niger. Four members of its military contingent are alleged to have been involved in sex with two different minors, possibly in exchange for money, on several occasions. These crimes are alleged to have been committed between July and October of 2015. The UN sent a request to have a national investigation officer appointed. We did not receive a reply in the established 10-day timeframe. As a result, OIOS has begun the investigative process on that case. The last case involves Senegal. In this case, two members of its police contingent, not military, but police. They are alleged to have been involved with sex with a minor between November and December of 2015. Because these are members of a police contingent and not military, the UN is investigating those allegations in accordance with established procedures. So we have a total of six identified victims in these five allegations, all of whom are minors. I think it's hard to imagine the outrage that people working for the United Nations and for the causes of peace and security feel when these kinds of allegations come to light. Particularly involving minors, which are so hard to understand. The United Nations is doing everything we possibly can to assist the victims, to bring accountability and justice for them, and hopefully to prevent these cases from, or any such cases from, recurring. I particularly want to commend the Secretary General's Special Representative, Parfait Onyanga, who has shown exemplary leadership on the ground in pursuing not only these individual allegations, but the cause that we all share of preventing and appropriately responding to sexual exploitation and abuse and assisting the victims. That mission is confronting a number of challenges, but the SRSG has made combating SEA a top priority for him and has taken a number of initiatives on the ground together with the High Commissioner for Human Rights Office including joint teams, proactive patrolling in areas where SEA there's a higher risk for SEA, for instance, the camp for internally displaced persons in Mapoko, or next to the airport. So the team on the ground led by the SRSG has really shown the kind of leadership that I know the Secretary General expects to see from all UN personnel. But he can't do it alone, and the senior staff and even the responsible people can't do it alone. The responsibility to combat sexual exploitation and abuse is one that all United Nations personnel share, and UN personnel are not just encouraged, they are actually obliged to report any allegation of sexual exploitation and abuse that they become aware of. They are obliged to report it, and any failure to report that is not only a transgression of their responsibilities to the UN, it makes them complicit with the perpetrators of those crimes. And that message, I think, is one that has been conveyed not only by the Secretary General, but leadership throughout the system. But in case there's any doubt whatsoever in anyone's mind, a UN staff member or other, UN personnel are obliged to bring information about these kinds of crimes to the attention of appropriate UN officials. And failure to do so is a serious offense within the UN, and it's a moral crime as well, in my view. But the United Nations, no matter how committed the Secretary General is, no matter how hard he tries, and his senior officials try, and individual staff members try, the United Nations cannot solve this problem on our own. We need the help of and partnership of the true contributing countries. They have such an important role to play in this. On the prevention side, the training, it's essential that that kind of training be done of a high quality nature back before deployment. The leadership of their officers is essential. On the accountability side, there are essentially three things that are necessary for criminal accountability and justice for the victims. A credible investigation, criminal investigation, a prosecution, and a judicial judgment, a decision in a court, military or civil. All three of those are the responsibilities of member states. The United Nations is not authorized to conduct criminal investigations, to prosecute, or to judge. So we need the support and commitment of our partners, our member states, our true contributors, to work with us and share this commitment, as I know they generally do, in order to achieve that kind of justice for the victims. The High Commissioner for Human Rights and his statement today made that clear. The Secretary General made it clear when he met with the true contributing countries on September 17th to brief them on his initiatives to consult on the issue of naming countries involved, and especially to ask them for their help and to place responsibility, the shared responsibility that they have where it belongs. So I think with the commitment of member states and the very strong commitment of the Secretary General, we will hopefully continue to make progress, and we won't rest until we're down to zero cases and zero victims. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. Evan.
Thank you, Steph. Thank you, Mr. Banbury. I welcome you on behalf of the United Nations Correspondent Association. My name is Evelyn Leopold, contributor to Huffington Post. I assume the investigations are still going on. Could there be more contingents involved? And secondly, are the accused still on site? Are they still functioning? Have they been sent home, or are they in the barracks, and so forth? And third of all, is your website up yet? Do you have a URL for it?
Thank you. The reason we uncovered these allegations is because of a proactive approach on the ground by the SRSG, Mr. Onyanka, and the High Commissioner's Office. That proactive approach will continue going forward with this joint UN team. And it's entirely possible that through that proactive effort to uncover cases, that more will come to light. Of course, we hope they won't, but it's entirely possible, if not probable, that more allegations will come forward in the future. Regarding the specific information, different allegations occurred at different times. We have different quality of information for them in terms of identification of the people who might have been involved. Some of the contingents have rotated. So I'm not going to go into more detail on the individual allegations here. It's really hard to get good information on the allegations, and we don't want to do anything that would interrupt an investigation. So there's just not more information to share on these specific allegations at this stage, but we will be sharing it eventually when we have more determined information. In terms of the website will be up and running following the issuance of the SG's report, so toward the end of February. It's because it's a whole new set of information that's going to be shared that will start after the issuance of the Secretary General's report.
That you don't know if they're still functioning and the accused, if there's... It's different for each person?
It's different for each contingent. For instance, the one involved in Morocco took place allegedly 2 years ago, so that those people certainly have rotated.
Thank you very much. My name is Emma. First of all, could you tell us more about this proactive approach on the ground? For example, the allegations that were announced today. Was this joint UN team randomly interviewing girls or vulnerable populations, or did they get some sort of a tip that there might have been something that happened to these girls? And secondly, is there now an understanding that the TCCs will have to make it public what happened to these alleged perpetrators, that at the end of the day, the investigation, you know, we'll all see what happened at the end, and the victims will see what happened to the perpetrators, whether they were convicted, whether they were put away to prison, or, you know.
On the first point, I actually began my career in the United Nations as a human rights officer investigating sex crimes and murders and tortures in displaced persons camps. It was pretty grim, and I'm sure the UN joint team is not just randomly interviewing people. They are going to areas that they know, like IDP camps, where there could be increased risks of SEA. I'm sure they're in touch with the community. UNICEF has their people on the ground. They work with national staff, and so they kind of know where to aim their efforts. What's important there, and this involves other UN agencies like UNICEF, for instance, UNFPA. This is really the first time we've seen the United Nations working in this way, in such a proactive way and an integrated way, with different parts of the UN working together on the investigation side, or not investigation, on kind of the uncovering side, finding out about these allegations so they can be properly investigated. But also they're working very collaboratively on the victim assistance side. So I think it's what the team on the ground, SRSG, Young and others are doing now is really a model that would be very applicable perhaps in other cases. Most missions, we don't have this, so we don't necessarily need to apply the same model, but where we are facing this kind of difficulty, then those kinds of proactive initiatives, night patrolling around the IDP camps. The SRSG and the force commander have put in place a curfew for the military, where they're not allowed outside their bases between the hours. I have it here somewhere, I forget exactly, but it's basically around 8 or 9 p.m. until 7 a.m., unless they're out patrolling and doing their mandate activities. The SRSG and Force Commander have put in place a non-fraternization policy. So I think those proactive measures are well, certainly entirely appropriate, reflect the commitment of the United Nations, and will have an impact. In terms of... I'm sorry, what was your second question? There was,
TCCs now on the
stand. It's up to the TCC, but there's a very high expectation on the part of the United Nations that we will be informed of whatever action is taken. They may try a person and conclude the person's innocent. whatever the outcome of the judicial process is, it is our expectation that we will be informed. And we keep going back and asking and asking and asking. And when we are informed, we will put it on the website. I also think now with the Secretary General's, well, he's been committed to transparency for a long time, but with the new steps we're taking to fulfill that commitment on the website, I don't think TCCs are going to want to see that that information across the page that says date of allegation, date the investigation began, etc., and at the end, you know, no action reported or something like that. So I hope that TCCs will see it as in their interest and only fair to victims that their actions are indeed reported.
Now,
Mr. Banbury, I just wanted to clarify just a few things. Are the cases that you detailed today on top of the 22 for MINUSCA, or is it the same, or are they in the 22?
They're part of the 22.
Part of the 22. But you detailed 5 cases today. How do you count allegations? Is it one, it's not one allegation, or it's... So I'm not clear, because it seems like there are 5 different instances that you detailed today. And of the 22, do you have any information on any of prosecutions or outcomes of investigations?
The science and art of counting allegations is really complicated. It's not clear. If there are 2 members involved and it takes place over several months, is that one allegation? What if there's someone, there's a third victim, but it's the same 2 people going to the same establishment, perhaps? You know, so it's hard, and there isn't, unfortunately, a really clear dividing line sometimes between saying, oh, this is one allegation or 2 allegations. It depends on the number of perpetrators, the number of victims. Is it more than one location or not? What's the time frame? So I could spend a lot of time trying to explain exactly how we do it here, but it's not really a precise science. I'm sure if you're really interested in getting into the details, our team in the Conduct and Discipline Unit, where we have legal experts, could walk you or anyone else who's interested in the information through specifically the approach we take on that. In terms of the other cases, they are all at different stages, and in some cases, investigations ongoing. It's being done by the UN. It's being done by the true contributing country. And when the SG's report comes out in February, and in particular, when the information goes up on the website, you'll see that information in much more detail. I did not bring information on any of the other cases with me, and I am not in a position to say today to provide information on additional cases today. I'm sorry.
Matt, thanks a lot. Matthew Lee, InterCity Press, on behalf of the Free UN Culture for Access. Thanks for the briefing, and also I'm sorry that you were upset. It definitely is upsetting, and maybe it should have been somebody else speaking, but I'm going to ask you first.
Allergies.
No, it really is. It's appreciated. But the question is, are there other allegations out there? And I want to ask you, because in the Washington Post of January 11th, in an article you're quoted in, they talk about other allegations involving peacekeepers from Gabon and Burundi. And I wanted to ask you directly whether there are allegations out there about Republic of Congo, Congo-Brazzaville troops. And I also wanted to, you seem to say, on TCCs, but the Deschamps report had a whole section about the Undersecretary General of Peacekeeping and his failure to vet those who were rehatted into the UN as being, which seems pretty clearly to be related to the number of rapes. You're saying MINUSCA's had more rapes than other missions. So I guess, what do you say about that section? Why isn't that individual answering the questions raised by the Deschamps report? And on the overall decrease in numbers, could this be a product of retaliation or fear of whistleblowers to come forward? Because as you know, Mr. Compass has said that the Undersecretary General of Peacekeeping tried to get him fired for coming forward, and has said in an interview that other people in the field have almost committed suicide because they feel unable to report these kind of crimes. So how do you respond to that? Thanks.
There are definitely other allegations. solutions out there. And we are working with other partners inside the UN and outside the UN on different allegations and different sets of allegations. Human Rights Watch is a very important, credible organization that is doing a lot of good, including in CAR. And if they are, or any organization, international or national, are able to come to us with credible allegations, then of course we will follow up, and we're grateful to them when they do it. And indeed, it's with that thinking in mind that we are trying to establish much stronger ties with community-based organizations who we think will bring allegations to us. If some poor girl has been raped, she may not feel very comfortable going up to a big UN base with barbed wire and soldiers with guns and flak jackets on. But through our work with community-based organizations, hopefully that girl, her mother, father, will feel comfortable approaching that organization, who can then come to us. If it's Human Rights Watch, if it's any other NGO or UN agency, that, you know, we'll take the information from wherever it comes, and then we'll start the process of investigating to determine, are they credible? And if they are, then the whole process continues. And that is happening with some other cases now that have been brought to our attention. On the second issue. If I seem to suggest that somehow it was just a member state responsibility, then I was not clear, and I'm sorry for that. It is absolutely a shared responsibility. The United Nations has a very, very important responsibility. These are United Nations missions, United Nations personnel, and no one has a greater interest in addressing this problem than the United Nations. The Secretary General has been incredibly strong and persistent and proactive on this, and the rest of us are trying to follow that lead and doing everything we possibly can, but we can't do it on our own. So that's the point I was trying to make. We will only be successful if we have a functioning partnership between the true contributors and the United Nations. So on that criminal accountability, the criminal investigation, the prosecution, and the judgment, all three of those depend on the member states, the true contributor. So we can help with that, but we have to do it together. In terms of the last one, I was very surprised when I heard or read suggestions or claims that UN people were afraid to report on cases of sexual exploitation and abuse. Why on earth would they be afraid to report it? That's they should run to their supervisor, the head of the mission, the human rights person, UNICEF. I mean, if anyone with any integrity at all, if they come across information like this, will immediately report it to someone in the United Nations, some official. And I can't stress enough their obligation as UN staff to do it, and their moral obligation as a human being to do it. And I've never heard, literally in the 6+ years I've been in this job, where this stuff is under my responsibility, never once heard the suggestion that someone would be afraid to report on claims of SEA for fear of retaliation. I've visited a lot of missions. I spent a lot of time out there. So honestly, I don't buy it.
And one follow-up. Look at what happened with Mr. Compass. I'm just going to say he didn't threaten. He's not the one saying he threatened to commit suicide, but he was put through the ringer and essentially fired, had to go through the system. What I wanted to just add is I just wanted to be very clear on one thing. The Washington Post article of January 11th, which quotes you, it says, in interviews, UN officials said that peacekeepers were from Gabon, Morocco, Burundi, and France. So my question is, if this was the 11th, and this is now the 29th, so this is several weeks, what is the protocol for the UN going public? Are these ones still in the hopper, about to be announced in some future press conference? And how long does it take between the UN knowing enough to tell the Washington Post these allegations are real and being announced either from Geneva or here?
On the matter of retaliation or whatever, I spoke to the High Commissioner for Human Rights on that case relatively early on, before any of the brouhaha, and he conveyed to me, before there was any reporting of it anywhere, how concerned he was for the victims, and he was genuinely concerned for the welfare of the victims, and that their names were out in the public. So it wasn't about reporting SEA, the concern, I'm 100% convinced that High Commissioner's legitimate concern was the welfare of victims, and I think that's admirable. On the matter of when are we going to report, etc., we're in the transition phase. We are going from a process that we followed for many years to a new approach, implementing the Secretary General's commitment on transparency. The original intention was to really roll that out through the issuance of his report at the end of February. However, in consultation with the High Commissioner's office, because we came as part of a joint team, we jointly became aware of these new allegations. We wanted to have kind of equivalents of information out there, and this is just advancing in a very little time the implementation of this new approach to reporting. So you will, I think, see a very standard approach as of the issuance of the SG's report in February.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Bamber, for the briefing. My name is Abdelhamid Sayan from the Arabic Daily Al-Quds Al-Arabi. The whole issue of sexual abuse of minors has three dimensions: investigation, and then establishing there is a crime and punishment. And the third part, which you didn't talk about, is the compensation for the victims. Is there a system of compensation? What do you do when a crime has been established, some criminal indictment of the perpetrator, for those who did it, and then the compensation for the victims? How do you address that issue?
Thank you for raising that. And I think I did refer, although maybe too briefly in my remarks, to the trust fund that's being established to assist victims, established by the Secretary General. The victims really are our greatest concern and preoccupation. We have now in place a very strong, I think, victim assistance program. Working with these community organizations, we're going to that also strengthens our ability to assist the victims. The focus at present in terms of victim assistance is through the kind of psychosocial and medical type of assistance that any victim of a sexual crime deserves, needs, can benefit from. So it's not so much compensation, it's more victim support. We also now are working very actively in the case of a victim becoming pregnant to find ways to ensure that the welfare of the child is looked after by the individual responsible. So where the member state that sends a military person, when they have, when they recognize DNA, for instance, for paternity, for confirming paternity, we will work to collect a DNA sample of the child and share it with the national authorities to establish paternity, and then we will work with the victim to, basically, we have to go through the national, they have to go through the national legal system to seek child support, essentially. So we have lawyers who work with the victim where she is, as well as helping them reach out to the member state and work through their legal system to get child support. So we are doing a number of things and more that I could go into in that area.
Go ahead, just a quick, and then we'll go to Dulcie.
How much money is in the victim trust fund, and how much of that came from payments withheld to the TCCs?
Good question. I'm sorry I don't have the figures with me, but we can get back to you on that. Yeah, sure.
Hi. Thanks very much. So what is it about Central African Republic, the mission there that's been going on for several years now, what is it about that mission that's generating so much sex abuse allegations? And is there anything being done about the Mpoko camp, dismantling it, you know, creating some other type of site that doesn't seem so obviously problematic? Thanks.
I have asked myself the same question you just asked, the first one, many times, because I think it's important to try and understand that in order to address the problem. Solving a problem starts with understanding it, its causes, its origins. And we had previously, in an effort to try and get at the root of these problems, we had previously appointed an independent panel of outside experts who were not legal experts, but like sociologists and you know, academic experts who look more at the social dimension of this, who could help explain some of it to us. And they came back with a number of findings and recommendations, one of which was you need to do much better outreach to the community and have relationships with community organizations for reasons I previously explained. So that kind of thinking is really important, trying to understand it. I can speculate, I have my own guesses, but I'm not an expert, but we need to try and understand that better. And I'm sorry, I don't have good insight into it. I wish I did. One thing that is of concern to me is that we have United Nations standards for our military contingents, and it's important that all contingents that are deployed to a UN peacekeeping operation meet those United Nations standards for training, performance, etc. And I think, and Matthew referred to this, in the case of the rehadding, we inherited some contingents that had not gone through the normal pre-deployment training, the SEA training, the kind of vetting that we normally do. That's something of concern. In terms of Mapoko, I think everyone would like to see it moved. It's the location is terrible. The conditions are terrible. But I believe very well-intentioned national and international officials have struggled with how best to address that. And they would like to see it move, but it's not so easy to convince that number of people to move, particularly when there aren't great options for them.
Two more questions and we're going to let Tony go. Celia.
Celia de la Varenne for Le Nouvel Obs. I just wanted to tell you how surprised I am to hear you saying that after all those years at the UN, you never heard anybody who told you that he faced retaliation because he was a whistleblower. If you want, I'm going to show you an article that I wrote not too long ago, and you will see how many people had to resign or went through hell because they did the right thing.
Celia, is there a question?
Yeah. Know about that.
Let me just briefly clarify. I said I have never heard of anyone fearing for their job, their position, or being afraid of retaliation for reporting a case of sexual exploitation and abuse. I wasn't speaking about whistleblowing writ large on all matters, but for SEA, I have never heard of that, and I would be dismayed if someone felt that they couldn't, that not only could they not, that they didn't have an obligation to report it. They have an obligation, and they are complicit. Anyone who doesn't report that information is complicit in that crime.
My name is Ibtissam Azim from Al Arabiya newspaper. I have a question. There was some suggestion to have more women in peacekeeping missions. What about that? And what about,
The Secretary General has been very clear on his commitment to increasing the participation of women in peacekeeping, as have the Undersecretaries General for Field Support and Peacekeeping. There are a whole range of initiatives that are being implemented to try and increase female participation, civilian, military, and police. The Secretary General appointed the first female force commander ever. He's appointed a large number of female SRSGs, deputy SRSGs, other senior officials. We have a talent outreach program for civilian women to attract women from different parts of the world into UN peacekeeping. So we all believe in the value of that for lots and lots of good reasons, including to help on this problem. We are not as successful as we would like to be in terms of reaching the numbers, but we are certainly trying very hard and very committed to it, and I would encourage you to consider serving in a peacekeeping mission. And any woman who'd like to, we the more the better, as far as I'm concerned.
Thank you very much. Tony, thank you for coming.
Thank you.